Mr. Grossman, thank you very much. You welcomed us in your home, in your beautiful home. I want to start
You are welcome.
Thank you very much. I want to start with your literature journey. You used to be a journalist and you were fired from your job. How did you decide to write? How did you say, I have to write something?
Well, it started many years ago. I was in love with a young woman. She left me. We had a quarrel about something and she just left me and took all her belongings. We lived together by then in Jerusalem. And she went to her home in Haifa and I was left shocked and devastated. And I was sure that if she doesn't love me, nobody in the world will like me even. And there was an accumulation of tension and of desire and despair, and I was almost physically led to a table that we had then. We lived together in a rented place, and I started in a second to write a story about an American soldier who deserted the war in Vietnam and he ran away to Austria of all places, and he has there he is totally lonely there, and the only ones who are showing some empathy to him is a bunch of donkeys. When he takes care of them, this is the only radiation of human warmth that he gets from the donkeys. And I wrote this story and I put it in an envelope and I sent it to her in Haifa without any explanation. And she read the letter and she came back to me. And we are now married for 45 years. So there are some good benefits and side effects to being a writer. And I think that then I became a writer. Then I really realized how existential it is for me to write. That now, of course, without writing, I'm not talking about publishing, but without writing, my life is not the life I want. I mean, in periods that I'm not writing, and sometimes between a book and the next book, I take half a year off or something. But then things, they just come one next to the other in a linear way. And it's not enough. And when I write, I feel that every detail of reality infuses some meaning to other details. And everything is intertwined and everything has a deeper meaning and a deeper layer. And I'm so much more alive when I write.
So in your Writing in the Dark book, you say, books that read me. So how do you define the books that make you a writer or influenced you?
Well, I think these are books that revealed me something about the nature of the world and of my nature. And there was in them some energy that uplifted me. But for example, I will tell you about another kind of a book that influenced me, that shaped my life, changed my life. And this is a book, or actually six books, by a Jewish writer who lived in Russia in the beginning of the 20th century. And his nickname was Shalom Aleichem. It's like Salam Aleikum. And this guy told about the life of the Jews in the small villages and little towns in the beginning of the 20th century. And my father one day, I remember, he came to my room and he had this book in his hands and he said, take it, David, read it. This is how it used to be over there. And over there was always a code for the countries that you are not allowed even to talk about, because the Shoah, the Holocaust, happened in them. Poland, Russia, Latvia. And I took this little volume with red cover and I sat on the window pane where I love to sit and to read. And I started to read and I was captivated immediately. The language was a little different from the new modern Hebrew that I grew up in. There was an air of mystery about the language. It was like an old prayer even. I remember that the pages were marked not by figures, numbers, but by letters. So it was like in the Bible or the Talmud. And I started to read about the life of the Jews in those little places, about the matchmaker and the one who drew water from the well, and the rabbis. And I suddenly realized that there is a whole reality there with its constitutions and establishments and language and anecdotes that I'm totally unaware of, but it works. It is very much alive. I think it's like for a child today to discover Harry Potter, exactly like that. And I started to read, and I read all the 6 volumes of Shalom Aleichem, stories that were meant, most of them, not for children, but for grown-ups. Political stories, the politics of the diaspora. And I read them because I know today they gave me the story of the childhood of my father, who rarely or almost never spoke about his childhood in one little town like those described in the stories of Shalom Aleichem.
When I look at modern history of Jews today, that can be started with Zionism and coming to this land, I feel like, yes, there was a diaspora literature for Jewish people, as you mentioned, diaspora literature. When I look at Palestinian literature, I can see some exile stories, exile literature. Do you feel some resemblance between exile stories of Palestinians and also diasporic literature of Jews?
I guess that every society, every people has his traumatic story. And this story shapes the mind of the people and in a way dictate their behavior, their values, their wishes for the future. A lot of what and who we are depends on these legislative stories that we keep telling ourselves. And those legislative stories, they have a very important role in the creating of a nation, of the consciousness of the nation, and they give a sense of belonging and of identity to every people. But I would go one step further after your question and ask, what if we look back at these legislative stories and we realize that they are imprisoning us, that they were very true and needed at the time, but time comes when they are just an obstacle for us to look at reality differently, to tell ourselves another story about ourselves and about our neighbors or enemies even, to see the text of the reality from another point of view. By the way, it's very recommended, not only for states, but also for individuals. And I think whenever I write about a human situation, it can be of a man and a woman, of parents and children, siblings, friends, I try to look at the story as I knew it before I started writing. I try to change it a little, like in a kaleidoscope, you know, to change and to see it from another point of view. And always when I'm able to do it, not always I am, but when I'm able, suddenly I breathe differently. I breathe with both lungs. You know, I feel I'm not a victim of this legislative story. I'm able not to be paralyzed by the legislative story that created me.
On our next episode of Showcase, we'll have much more from that interview with David Grossman in part 4 of our series on authors in Jerusalem.